for the invitation, because to come and have a chat. We were sort of thinking about what to talk about, and then sort of the topic, what makes family medicine complex, came up as something that might create some interest. Because we are just such a small group, what I wanted you to do is write on some post-it stamps what you think makes family medicine complex, and then we can compare notes at the end. So if you want to just give that a minute.
If you run out of space, there's plenty more. Complexity in primary care. Thank you. Even if I turn around at work already.
Yes. You have a task as soon as you arrive.
Up here.
Okay, the task is to quickly write down a few of your ideas why you think family medicine is complex. Here's some sticky tapes.
One idea per sticky type, or
I didn't know
if you're going to put them around.
Well, we have such a small group, it's, you can write on single ones or on several, doesn't matter. You came up with quite a few ideas, so that's pretty encouraging. sort of just by, before I continue, I'm not sure whether everyone saw the flyer. I'm a general practitioner or family doc, as they call them in the US. For the last 30 years, working the same practice, now mainly with elderly people. Sort of as I got older, my patients got older. Academic level, I'm not a full-time academic. I do this sort of as a hobby rather than as a profession. And for all my sins, I've pulled together the International Society for Systems and Complexity Sciences for health. By that, I mean that there are lots of different people contributing to health that are not medical, that belong to the field required to provide health care. And the whole idea of that is to have an umbrella organization so that people with working for health can exchange ideas and work together, try things out, collaborate, whatever emerges out of the opportunities. And it has only taken about 25 years to get to that stage. Okay, let's start. The ideas, or the headings about what makes family medicine complex, in my understanding, is context, context, context. Context is the thing that matters most in primary care and family medicine. It is a fact that we work at the interface between health and non-health. It's tricky, the work, because how do you make a diagnosis when most people don't have a diagnosis? It is about the basic understanding of what are causative features behind the complaint rather than just the disease. A lot of the work involves existential concerns, and they are not readily expressed. Expresses verb is always something that occurs in between the lines. At an academic level, I think primary care lacks a clear philosophical understanding and a research paradigm that goes with it. We work in systems that have reward systems that are based on non-health, that has implications for everyone and everything involved. What is that on? Try to use this. So, context. This is an image representation about the epidemiology of health in the community. And this work has been done already in 1961 by Kerr White, who showed that health is distributed according to a Pareto distribution. 80% of people are healthy or healthy enough not to require health care. Of the 80%, of the 20% that require health care, 80% require primary care, which is sort of family medicine, general practice. Of the remaining 20%, which in the end is then 3.2% of the community at large, they require secondary care, or you can call it instrumental care. They need their cataracts done, they need a hip replacement, they need a broken bone fixed, their appendix out, these type of things. 0.8% are the ones that end up in a tertiary hospital with severe end of the disease spectrum. The other notion that is poorly understood and articulated is a question of what is health in the first instance. And health has something to do with the notion of complexity. Complexity sciences deals with understanding the whole. And health comes from the old English word, hal, meaning whole. And then you have the nuances of illness and dis-ease, which is now the objective term disease, but meaning something completely different. Most people see the doctor because they use the English terms illness or meaning of not feeling well, dis-ease, rather than the disease itself. And this is a problem that has been tried to be tackled for quite a while, and I've put up on the slide here four conceptualizations that are all mutually agreeable. They come from different perspectives, but all talk about wholeness and integrated togetherness. The top left-hand one uses sort of the potential and demands and concept that if you have a particular potential and your demands on you are less than your potential, then you will be fine. If on the other hand your demands outstrip your potentials, then you will experience illness. And the third one of these ones shows that it doesn't really matter how big your potential is, it's more important how that matches up with your demands. The Magnum figure below sort of uses a dynamic concept of if you have too little or too much entropy in the system, you can't function, and it's life equaling health is sort of a very finely balanced state in between the two non-viable states. And then you have sort of the basic physiological model on the top right-hand side, the homeokinetic model. Most of the time you stay in there, occasionally you can break out with an acute illness but return back to normal. Or if that's suddenly not possible anymore, you have go through a transition and to develop a new stable state, which is different in character and in function. And you see that often with people with chronic diseases. And the bottom right-hand one is my own conceptualization that health is a dynamic state that is composed out of a balance between your physical, your emotional, your social, and your cognitive domains. And day by day, you have changes, but as the right-hand diagram shows, there are patterns. If you plot your health experience on a daily basis, there will be sort of slight differences of what contributes to your experience of health, but it's relatively stable in the center between the four domains.
You may want to explain what attractors are in this context.
An attractor is where the activity comes together as holds the activity in that place. If you look at the left bottom one, you see that there's sort of an excursion to the biological component, that sort of as a representation of an acute illness. You have appendicitis, your tummy hurts terribly, you have an operation, your tummy hurts even more, but then you recover from it and you return back to your old stable state. You can replace that with a broken bone or pneumonia, it really doesn't matter very much. That normal health, normal acute illness in the end becomes self-limiting and you return back to your old stable state. People who have chronic illnesses, for them, I think conceptually, they shift their balance to usually the physical side, because most of the chronic illnesses have a physical component, but there could be any other component too. If you think about youth living on the street, for them, it may not be the physical at that point. point in time, but more the emotional than social component. And usually when you get some problems, the excursions of then the effect of sudden social loss, if you have a chronic illness, is much more pronounced. So that's why the loops are becoming bigger. And then you can have a switch between stable states, the somatization illnesses. It can be the emotional being the big thing, and then it's a physical thing, and it swaps between these states. Health, in that way, it is understood as an experiential state. And that experiential state is explainable by, in this model, the four main components. And it's essentially an extension of the biopsychosocial model of angles. So, working at the interface, that is where most of family medicine takes place. And it raises sort of the question then, what is the role of the family doctor? And part of it is to manage the illness experiences and maintain health experiences that people desire. But at the same time, you also have to be a good diagnostician and an expert in managing many of the diseases. Currently, that's my point of contention, is that we educate doctors at large and in family medicine, with my involvement, seen it over and over again, what the trainees are interested in is disease management and whom the disease belongs to. They have much less interest in. But effective family medicine has to deal with the 80% of stuff for which there is no medical, meaning biomedical, intervention. And we come back to that in a moment. What we also know from studies done in primary care is that the 20% most common diagnosis in primary care occur in 80% of all patients, which also means that the other 80% of possible diagnoses only occur in 20% of the patients you see. Again, it's a classical Pareto distribution. And then there's a misconception here that we think the burden of mortality and morbidity is rising with age, and that people are really, really, really unhealthy. The reality is that most people, even at an advanced age, are healthy. I have chosen here to show just the number of people with three diagnoses, and I can't recall exactly how diagnosis was defined here, whether hypertension is already a diagnosis or not. In essence, it doesn't really detract from the distribution curve that most people are healthy most of the time, even at advanced age. So if you look at the red line, it shows you that 60% of all patients over 80 are still having only three diseases. This is about perceptional bias. And it's perceptional bias not only at a community level, it's also a perceptional bias for most clinicians. This is from David Cattendall's work. He looked at what makes family medicine more complex than other areas. And part of it is in this index at the bottom line, that you are confronted with lots of different issues constantly. And if you look at the second line, that there also is much more uncertainty in the patient population you are dealing with. And sort of cardiology, I'm not sure why the complexity index is as high as it is. I would have thought that lots of cardiology is reasonably straightforward, but that might be my misunderstanding. Psychiatry is really easy, relatively speaking, because there are only a handful of conditions and nothing in psychiatry is really changing dramatically. Things are usually slow in their progression. So if you then look at the issue of how do you arrive at a diagnosis, you know epidemiologically that most people who come to family medicine do not have a life-threatening thing, but who is it who has and how do you find out? And in this slide, it's a reminder about how the diagnostic process works. In the first key to diagnosis is listening. We know 80% of the diagnosis is history, 10% is added by physical examination. Investigations add a little bit, and the little bit that is left remains undefined anyway. And in the listening, the three circles indicate these are the three things that tell us the story. And if you think about it as the key features that make a diagnosis, if you have these three symptoms, it can be only one diagnosis. And you don't need an x-ray to make the diagnosis, that only confirms the diagnosis. And what the cause behind the diagnosis is, that can be variable. You can have bowel obstruction because you have a twist in the bowel, or you have adhesions, or you have a tumor. That's a secondary issue, but the diagnosis is established on the history alone. If you look at this story, I let you read it for yourself, and then you can tell me what are the key features in that story and what that adds up to.
What is NIDDM?
Non-insulin dependent diabetes. Clinicians here who can make something out of that?
Well, the duration of some of these needs a little more specificity in that most of these other things are either normal or relatively under control, except I don't know what you mean by he means about loss of memory and headache. Is that, but you gave me headaches and nausea that are increasing over recent time, I would focus on one set of things. And otherwise, I might back off and worry about some of the other parts of your four parameters of care, given a stable state and everything else. So I need a little more temporal detail.
So if you use this concept of what are the key features, you have things that, as you quite rightly point out, could be something or couldn't be anything, but there's no three things that add up to something that is known to be a clinical diagnosis. This is the typical way of presenting with an illness, and you have to make sense out of that illness experience. And your point is extremely important in my view, to say, tell me what you mean. Tell me what it means to you. How come, what happened in your life when you started to develop these symptoms? And it is in many ways a diagnostic approach. If you can't come up with a diagnosis, it's not a diagnosis, or it's not a disease, then you have to understand what the patient is actually worried about.
I was just looking around to see how many look like clinicians here, rather than me talking.
No, that's okay. And then there is another component to it, which is you cannot afford to miss important diagnoses. And here, there are features where externalities have an impact how you think. If someone has a fit for the first time, in a younger person, you probably think it's more likely to be primary epilepsy, whereas in a middle-aged person, you're probably much more worried about, is it a brain tumor? Where in the elderly, beside of a brain tumor, you probably think about bleeding, drug toxicity. Nothing of that is in any way specific, but it shows you that certain things trigger different diagnostic impressions, and these are impressions for a really quite serious presenting symptom. Other example, when you take it into chest pain, younger people are much more likely to have or anxiety-related muscle pain, where the elderly person, you worry about heart attacks and pulmonary embolism, or in the very elderly, osteoporotic fractures are pretty much on there. If you take fever, context matters again. Fever in a child in Africa is much more likely to be make you worry about malaria, whereas in the Western context, high fever in a child is really not telling you very much at all. It can be a variety of things. And then the issue of your ethnicity play a role. We know that certain conditions are much more common in some people's ethnic background than others.
And there's, of course, perception of issues. You have male versus female, and you get all this
stereotype.
Sorry.
Yeah, but it's a really important point, and that comes back to my first point on the overview slide. It's all about context.
Right.
And you need to take that into account, and you need to take it seriously into account. If you think about the underlying nature of the complaint, you end really up in looking at the web of life. The patient is sort of in the center of the web, and in the end, how things pan out have to do with, broadly speaking, socioeconomic characteristics, with education, with work, with access to transport, to hospitals. What happens in your immediate family and in your extended family. And one of the conceptualization to put that into a more dynamic picture is an attempt here. The person in the middle, we now from the discussion understand how the health and illness works out. And person is in the end, in between the external things to his life as well as his internal blueprint and functioning. And what we know is that they are constantly influencing each other. And your health influences your externalities. Your externalities influence your internalities. And if your internalities decrease in function, you get more illness, which then alters the way you function in the external way. And we actually, and I use mechanism here in inverted commas, know how the external environment gets under your skin. And it has to do with the overactivation of stress here meaning the physiological stress response, which activates the HPA axis and the autonomous nervous system. And we know now from a functional point of view how that triggers all the inflammatory pathways, and then there's a feedback loop. And there is at least these type of the hypothesis that if you measure heart rate variability, you may be able to capture the overall integrity of a person's function. And just to show here the, in a graphical way how you can plot the different factors that are that making up a person's whole state. Certain things are more positively, others are more negatively impacting on your well-being. And in that three-dimensional axis, you can have perturbations to your whole system on the physiological, on your interpretive or self-assessed health perspective, and on your external environment. And what in the end comes out of it may be very variable. So it just as a visualization of the concepts, rather than that it tells you a particular evidence story. And then the next point that makes general practice of family medicine complex is the fact that most of these patients you see are really telling you stories in between the lines. And if you don't listen to the patient's story, which takes on average 2 minutes, but doctors interrupt after on average of 11 seconds, you never get the picture. Ian McWhinney, who is one of my favorite philosophers and is regarded as a founding father of modern family medicine, has put it in the terms of the particulars. If you are not interested in the person with the illness, you are really missing your vocation, or you don't have a vocation because you're not really interested in what happens. And family medicine has no easy answers. And what may on one day sound as a really banal issue can next day be a really serious issue, and vice versa. Most of the time, family physicians get away with things because they have two advantages. One is the epidemiological knowledge that most patients are not dying on them this day. The second is they have an ongoing relationship with their patients, so the patient knows they can come back if things change. And most family doctors encourage a patient to say, I expect it going this way, but if you observe this or that, or if you're worried about something else we haven't talked about, come back and we'll see what it is.
I don't understand exactly what you mean by particulars. Do you mean the background, the nature of the patient?
Everything. It is about the personal component, it is about the disease they have and how they experience the disease, how the disease is progressing in them. But it's sort of the whole. It's not sort of, I've been facetious here, it's not about because it's interested in the heart, and it doesn't matter whom it belongs to, as long as it is a heart, as a cardiologist, he can deal with it. As a family physician, the view is, the heart is part of you, but lots of chest pain is not heart pain. It is heartache in the symbolic nature. If you work in a cardiac care unit, then invariably you see that filtered population, which me and my colleagues have identified as being ischemic heart disease that requires Vickers expertise to make them better again, or maybe even good again. And I have alluded to that in the remarks, that it is in the end about the healing relationship that develops. And cardiologists or neurologists or surgeons can develop a healing relationship with their patients too, but many of them are just too preoccupied to deal with the disease, and that healing relationship is often not there. And I see it in my practice all the time, that people come back and say, now I feel worse than I went when I went in there, and they say, I'm fixed. The other thing you hear often is there were 25 doctors seeing me. Everyone was interested in my heart, but no one was interested in me. That is the lack of building a healing relationship. It becomes instrumental, fixing a part in the Newtonian clockwork notion. Hear from a patient who had cancer and, herself the quote of making this point in the same words. The next point was about the research paradigm that fits the nature of the discipline. Cochrane may be known to most of you, the picture is pretty famous, the man in the middle. Knows anyone knows who that is? It's Ed Pellegrino. He's the foremost philosopher for medicine. He passed away at the age of 94, I think, just a few years ago. And Ian McWhinney is on the right. If you talk about scientific paradigms, there is a distinction between the Newtonian approach, which is symbolized by the so-called scientific method and goes back in many ways to Popper's philosophy. And it's a very neat model. It says you have observations that trigger you to ask a question, you formulate hypothesis and think that you can find a particular answer. And then you set up an experiment, you see what comes out of it, and either it proves your prediction or it disproves a prediction, and you move on. But while in physical sciences, this setting up of experiment is reasonably easy to do because you can make it a construct internally and externally valid. You can be sure that your measures are valid for what you want to measure. They are generalizable in the end, they're reliable, and they're repeatable. And that concept in physics works really well, but in the medical or in any kind of the living world, these underlying assumptions are not really easily held. And sort of to jump forward before coming back. The problem with EBM is that, as in the discussions that are going on in the email group we are on, is what they call GJO, garbage in, garbage out. The EBM methodology has significant shortcomings, which are based on the one hand negating the necessary context in which the data had been collected, and as Johnny Ioannidis has shown, if you repeat the now well established studies, they show a completely different result. So having the issue of unreliable setups, unreliable data, putting more unreliable data together is not giving you any greater wisdom than you had before. before. And part of the problem in the living sciences is that randomization as a gold standard just lacks major credibility, because variability is the norm, but the assumption is that you don't have any variability. For most problems that medicine is interested in, a randomized controlled trial is just not going to fit. Part of it is sort of the enshrined thinking in organ-based systems rather than in whole person systems. And the aim, and I put it in inverted commas, of EBM is essentially trying to define laws of medicine analogous to the physicists defining the laws of physics. So,
you should probably just point out to the non-clinicians in the room that EBM stands for evidence-based medicine, which is a whole paradigm of the last 20 years.
Yeah. Thanks. So, has complexity science something to offer as an alternative approach? And using that same diagram in a slightly modified form, if you understand that there are patterned features that you see in any form of living system, you then can sort of ask the question, how come that you belong into the purple group, you are in the green group, you belong in the yellow group, and so forth. And the methodologies used in systems and complexity sciences are slightly different, because you develop a mental model of something is happening that explains the pattern I observe, and you then develop a mathematical model, and there are different techniques available to then calibrate the model. And in the next step, your experiment is then creating what-if scenarios. If you understand what created the status quo, that's a calibration process, you understand, you have worked out the dynamical behavior and the interactions between the many different variables that you have identified and proven to be reliably recreating the status quo. You then can make better judgments rather than clear cut, this will happen, this is most likely to happen. And your observation or your proof of the what-if scenarios is that the proportions of the patterns do change. And a valid model you develop has the same criteria of validity, of reliability, of repeatability, and in the end then at least generalizability in the context of a given population from which the data have been arrived. And that in many ways has implications for health policy planning how to approach the same problem in different communities. I couldn't think about anything valid to say about the reward system, but very clearly the reward system in medicine is not based on health, it's based on non-health. And this is a very old cartoon from 1973 that I think nicely shows that it's maybe the reverse of what we are doing that's actually happening. And in terms of what drives the system, it's very clearly focused on money and diseases, where the two are very closely linked. You make money from treating disease, you don't make money from not creating disease. So the next question then that arises out of it, what should we measure? And I put it in this way, measure what matters. And there are really three constituencies that are requiring an answer to that. And for patients, measures that matter are how they perceive their health. And there's another term that comes from John Howie who talks about enablement. Did the consultation I have had help me to better cope with the condition I'm in? Whoop. For health professionals, what matters is, do I know the patient as a person? A more objective thing would be complication rates. There are probably a list of other things. And again, it probably depends a little bit on what context you're working in, what other parameters are meaningful measures. And from a health systems sustainability perspective, is the system able to provide in-time service delivery? One of the problems with the UK system is that you often have to wait for non-life-threatening interventions for quite a while. There are pluses and minuses for it. In urology, prostatectomy rate in the UK is very low because 80% of patients who have to wait 2 years to get their prostatectomy done don't need it anymore. But for other things, it may be much more of a hassle to have to wait. If you have to wait 3 years for your cancer treatment with bowel obstruction from a tumor, you're probably not there to receive your operation anymore. And then is a question of return on investment. One of the things that, particularly in your own context, is often not talked about, and in all contexts it becomes ever more the neoliberal doctrine of putting money into social services means the government hands out your hard-earned tax dollars to dodgers. But the reality is that every dollar invested into social services has a net return of a minimum of $2 to up to $25, depending on what domain you look at. So again, there's not the awareness that return on investment is a valid way of looking at it. It can be a very objective way of looking at it, but ideology may very much stand in the way. Now you have to construct with your own ideas what complexities did you think of and how much are they congruent or incongruent with my ideas on the topic.
Well, I cheated because I just wrote down one thing that tried to just encompass it all. And that was, what makes it complex is grappling with the full range of issues of health and well-being for multiple human beings in various relationships with each other.
Well, that's a nice summary.
But it is just that summary.
Okay, guys, don't be shy. I don't bite.
I'm trying to organize mine and see if something makes sense.
Ashley, go.
Sure. Okay. So I put geography, family structure, employment status, prescription needs, the healthcare system itself, mental health issues, integration with primary care, insurance status, race, ethnicity, age, provider relationship, transportation access, chronic illness management, any presence of social work support, language barriers, cultural differences, immigration status, time, doctors themselves, specialist integration with primary care. I can't read the others.
You could have given the talk.
What did you mean, doctors themselves?
Well, I was really struck when you were talking about how doctors don't see the whole person and are, you know, interrupt after a certain measured amount of time without allowing the individual to complete their narrative. And that's a barrier that doctors need to kind of. But of course, it's time constraint also. It's complicated.
Yeah, the interesting thing is, I'm the doctor in my practice who's always running late. But I never seen the patient twice for the same thing. In the end, this again is sort of a way you frame your analysis. If it's on the day, I'm a lousy doctor. If you look at it over the year, I'm a much more effective and efficient doctor. Because the patient, in the end, the patient wants a good answer, a good understanding of his or her problem at the time they see you. And yes, it takes time, and sometimes it takes exceptionally more time than you have sort of on average allocated. But it's fun. It satisfies. Leaving a patient hanging there. If I can't figure out what's wrong with the patient, then it's my problem. I haven't figured it out. It's not the problem of the patient. Every patient has, in the end, a problem that's understandable. Maybe except the psychopath. But I don't see that.
You just don't know you see them. Skies in here. Come on.
Well, I always say I work in a sheltered workshop. I work in a very peculiar area. If I go just a mile down the road to another practice, it's a completely different story. So, yeah, I take the point. It might be my blind spot too, but I haven't experienced it. Okay, where's other additional points?
Well, it's hard to get additional. I mean, between the general scope and the particulars, mine essentially said in about 8 lines, too many issues, too little time. But the issues represent both things on the pathological diagnostic thing and the social and the personal and the psychological, and not to speak of the administrative issues that people in primary care in this country have to grapple with, either by trying to define their own sort of program and pattern of care, or by being stuffed into a matrix of somebody else's, usually a corporate structure of care, that limits or penalizes misuse of time. I mean, your style of practice worked for a number of us who got old enough to be tolerated to be able to do it in this country, but many of the younger people have many more constraints. And by the way, I asked about particulars, because the particulars in terms of details of the patients, I mean, I think of examples coming up right and left as you gave the talk, like the fever in the child or the adult in the UK or the United States. I'm primary care, but infectious disease. So, you know, immediately the first question I'd ask is, have you been traveling to Africa? And I do have one cute story, and there are several stories we all have on how important it is to learn some other personal detail about the patient, not just for that fact, but for the demonstration to the patient of the fact you're actually interested in this. So I'm interested. I have two things I would have asked you about, but you can finish asking us for all of our
other issues. Discussion is coming shortly. I'm impressed that you essentially come up with the same concepts and issues that I sort of talked about, maybe in slightly different terms. So it's encouraging for me to see that within the realm of the primary care arena, people with different backgrounds have the same experiences and see the same issues as important things to tackle. Does anyone want to add something else?
I was just playing with the pieces, like instead of the variables, the ability or inability to be flexible among different kinds of scripts operating at once, as opposed to going down a road and staying on that, on one path, requires a lot of ability to adapt.
I wrote like something very similar to him. It's like a summary of everything. I read the challenge of treating not only a